So before I get started, I wanted to get a general sense of who is here today. Those of you I don't know yet, how many people here are from the DC region? Whoa. Okay. Cool. How many of you have been previously involved with an atheist or a skeptic or a secular or humanist group? How many of you have not? Okay. All right. Good. So I'm very excited to be here today, and thank you, too, for inviting me to be part of this on stage. When I was going back and forth with Rachel and Ashton and Diane about what to talk about here at this convention, at this event, I had two different directions in mind. One of them was to talk about how to do activism effectively, because part of this is to be a training event, and another was to, I could say rail, but discuss, maybe entertain some ideas about some of the issues that we see within the humanist community and what we could do about them. But if a lot of you are not in the humanist community, then some of that would be probably bizarre. And then we could just talk about activism. And so I emailed Ashton and Diane and Rachel and said, which of these would be a better fit for this event? And they said, we like both. can you do, well, we don't have any training on the program yet, so can you talk about sort of how to do activism more effectively and maybe sprinkle in some of the other talk, maybe combine them? And I was like, do you have an hour and a half? Because then yes, and if not, I'm not sure. But I thought perhaps I could frame some discussion about activism around some of the issues that I think exist within the humanist community, for those who are familiar. So, and very quickly, maybe, we'll see. So I'll start with a brief story. In 2011, while I was working at the Center for Inquiry, I was sent to the International Humanist and Ethical Union Conference, which takes place, the World Congress takes place every 3 years in a different part of the world. That year, it was in Oslo in Norway. It was a great opportunity to meet activists from all over the place, from India and Nigeria and Belgium and wherever. I ended up hanging out a lot with the members of the International Humanist and Ethical Youth Organization. We stayed up late, didn't drink too much because drinks were very, very expensive in Oslo. Did some drinking though. And as organizers often do when we get together, did a little bit of ranting about our respective environments that we were working in. That happens. And at some point when there was a lot of frustration expressed about perhaps when we first got involved with the humanist community, we didn't expect to encounter some of the issues that we did. We thought that people would be more intersectional, more open-minded, more woke. And so it was, it could be a surprise to us to see that there were still issues with understanding power, understanding structural issues, understanding racism and sexism and whatnot. And as we were expressing this frustration about this and saying, like, why do we face this? If we're approaching this rationally, if we're approaching this from this foundational set of values that we share, then why do we still see these issues within humanism? And I swear I wasn't drunk, said, did you ever see the movie Soylent Green? And no one had, because they were young and I watch old movies all the time. And I said, well, there's a scene where there's overcrowding, it's a dystopian future, and there's a food product that's produced by the government. And towards the end, the main character learns that the food product is produced from people and says famously, Soylent Green is people. It's people! And I said the same is true with humanism. The reason we see these issues is because humanism is people. It's people! And so, of course, we're going to see us all as people getting together, having the same kinds of issues that any people have when we organize in groups. And actually, we started a Facebook group after that and everything called Humanism is People to stay connected. But that actually, I found, was a very useful framing for me as an organizer to think about how to do activism more effectively. So I mentioned that there are issues sometimes in the humanist community. And when I got asked once to give a presentation on humanism and race, class, and gender, I ended up distilling the problems I saw with humanism into three areas. And my approach to it was that it's not just a problem because we're people getting together. The three problem areas that I was thinking of ended up being problems because of how humanists think about what humanism is and requires. So problems of understanding of humanist philosophy, the foundations of humanism. The first problem area, I have a lot of notes, was that humanism often, people's understanding of humanism relies on a caricature of the Enlightenment. So we value things like science with a capital S, science, and reason, and liberty, and freedom, and that can lean towards libertarianism, individualism, things like this. And so for many people, when you talk about things like, that was gonna be very political. let me take that back. And let me stick better to my, this is being recorded, y'all. If it wasn't, this is gonna be on the internet later. Yeah, stop by my table later. I'll be there. I'll be happy to talk about stuff, don't record me. But yeah, the scientific method, rationality, evidence-based approaches to things. Intellectualism, right? Free speech. These are all ideas that we associate with the Enlightenment. This idea of the progress of civilization, and that there can be better, some civilizations are better than others, right? But is there anything wrong with this? Yes, I think so. I think you think so too. First, philosophically speaking, and in like intellectual history, that's not all that the Enlightenment was about. So it's a false view of what the Enlightenment even captures. Even Hume said, and Hume was an Enlightenment philosopher, quote, reason is and ought only to be the slave of the passions. Our reasoning comes from our emotional base. Rousseau also said similar things about reason stemming from our emotions and our positionality. When we discount emotion, we reduce our ability to recognize our own biases, and we diminish our empathy for others. So that's problem one, the idea that we can be like rational robots that discard our emotions and our backgrounds. Second, of course, this cartoon Enlightenment ignores anything harmful or negative that came out of the Enlightenment. Like the way that science can be used as a tool for different kinds of purposes. Third, the Enlightenment was an intellectual trend hundreds of years ago. And after the Enlightenment, there were other areas of research and study. There were other academic fields that were developed, scientific fields that were developed that help us understand ourselves, our science, our world better. Things like psychology, That was a post-Enlightenment field. Sociology, another post-Enlightenment field. So if we draw only from a stereotype of what the Enlightenment was about, we miss out on ways of thinking about ourselves and the world that can help bring us to, I think, a realer understanding. So that was problem area one. Problem area two is that often we say humanism is good without God, right? But what it actually looks like in practice for many of us in our humanist communities is that humanism is good without God! Double underline, exclamation point, right? We focus on the fact that we're non-religious, that we exist as an idea in contrast to religion and religious people and religious belief. This defines and shapes our agenda and our culture and our communities. So the issues that we can engage with are things like church-state separation, prayer in public schools, prayer at football games, even teaching evolution in science class rather than anything that seems connected to religion, intelligent design, creation theory, right? But we have a harder time engaging with things that can't be framed in the simple us versus religion, us versus the religious right kind of frame. Racial justice work, for many people in the humanist community, who are we who are organizing for racial justice, fighting against? But the framing isn't we who are fighting for racial justice are fighting religion. And so they will say that is a fringe issue that's outside of our work, that's outside of our community. People can have different ideas on that. We should listen to all the sides, things like that. But even some of the kind of classic, more social justice-leaning humanist work like same-sex marriage as an issue, right? Very few humanists would have said that that should be outside of our work. Because we fight religion when we fought for same-sex marriage and when we fight for LGBTQ equality. When we're fighting religion, that's a fight that many humanists are familiar with. So it's not actually that I think we're pro, we were pro same-sex marriage in the broader humanist community. We were anti-same-sex marriage. We were fighting religion, and so we were very, very comfortable with that issue. Abortion, for many humanists, is similar. We fight religion. We don't want religion to shape how the government works and decides things like this. That's why we're involved. I have some quotes about this, but I think you understand the point, right? Yes, yeah. Humanist groups in prisons, that's our issue. We're fighting religion. Humanist chaplains, that's our issue. We want the same kind of representation that religion has had. Why is this a problem? Well, one, because humanism should be a positive life stance, right? We should talk about what we do believe and what we are fighting for and what kind of world we want to build, not just to tear down religion, but what are we building to replace that? And when we don't look at some of these issues, we end up reinforcing oppressive structures within our own communities. Is the world a better place if let's say the US? Is the US better? Do we get rid of the issues in the US if everyone is just like, I'm a humanist and I don't believe in God now? How many issues don't go away if that's what happens, right? So I think it's worthwhile to consider other kinds of issues that we can get involved in. And if we're not informed on them in the humanist community, within our communities, then we can spend time learning about them. If we're like, well, racial justice work, I don't know, then let's have some talks at our meetings about that kind of thing, right? And we do. I'm not saying it never happens, I'm saying we should all be fans of that. Problem 3 of 3. We are all individuals. Each and every one of us, unique as can be. And this is a very important part of humanist philosophy. It's in the humanist manifestos. Even the American Humanist Association's website has a long article saying the humanist philosophy and perspective with 8 basic principles of humanism. The first starts out by saying, we humanists think for ourselves as individuals. So these ideas include individual freedom, individual responsibility. The philosophy of humanism rejects prejudice based on race, class, gender, and similar characteristics. So I'm sure people could hear this and say, yeah, that's right. Yay, good for us. how could that be a problem? And I see some of your faces and you're like, yes. So how is this a problem? Because the humanists who come from that kind of perspective, while ignoring some other ways of thinking about how people are, will reject things like understanding that race exists and affects us, right? They'll say, I'm a humanist. Humanists should be colorblind. Race isn't real. It's not a biological fact. Why are you paying attention to race? That's divisive. That's identity politics. Shouldn't we all be one and approach this equally? And so when you talk about things like structural racism, the importance of diversity, say, I don't see color. I only see everyone as an individual. Right? Additionally, if everyone's an individual in this kind of way, class becomes nearly impossible to understand. Privilege, what the heck is that even? You can't even think about privilege unless you understand how to think about people and groups, how to think about this group membership as shaping who we are and what we have access to. Keep pretending that's closer than it is. Also, I've seen pushback. I was the director of African Americans for Humanism for almost nine years. And some of the pushback that we got for having a program called African Americans for Humanism came from staunch humanists who said, why not just humans for humanism? Why have a separate group? That's divisive. Could I go to your meetings? Why are you excluding me from your meetings? And that comes from that kind of idea that humanism should discard these ideas of racial difference. Ignore it. But again, how can you address racism if you don't let yourself see that race is a thing that affects people? So those were the three kind of philosophical problems I had with the way that some people understand humanism. One, that many humanists have a strong commitment to a caricature of the Enlightenment and Enlightenment values. Two, that our identity and culture is primarily grounded in non-belief and opposition to religion, in contrast to the dominant religion we're in, rather than espousing positive values. And three, we have a strong commitment to individualism, and therefore we can be uncomfortable with the idea that people are shaped by their culture and their experience and their race and their gender and other things. So the problems occur when these ideas about what our core values are and what the foundations of humanism are impede our ability to be good humanists and hamper our movement's ability to promote humanism and attract others to it, including demographics we haven't historically attracted. I don't need to tell you more about that either, I'm sure. But yeah, coming from that, that was my hour-long presentation summarized in less than an hour. Yay. There are two ways that I thought of for how we can improve humanism. I don't like to just say like, hey, there are problems. Thank you. Thank you very much. Come see me at my table. Two ways that I thought, I always like to have some kind of like action item or like, what can we do about this kind of thing if I'm doing a talk about something. So I was like, I don't know. Who am I? I don't have all the answers. There have been plenty of books and things written about this. There's plenty of online spaces where people are talking about this. But there are two areas that I thought we could work to have improvements to how our humanist communities work. One is that we should respect and appreciate the social sciences more and be informed by them more. A lot of humanists aren't. Oh, wait. Being recorded. Man. Damn. Some people out there, because of their scientific background and their mega rational brain, I guess, really dismiss the soft sciences, the human sciences, things like sociology, things like social psychology, things that have to do with how people actually are. Because they're so rational, I guess they think that they've removed themselves from that kind of being human. I'm just thinking names right now, but I'm not going to say them. Some people I hear. So I think one thing that we can do is value the soft sciences more. You know, they're not easy because humans aren't easy and we're not simple. And I said once before, kind of flippantly, but I thought actually, that if there are physicists, say, out there who say, you know, sociology is not a real science, it's a soft science, and they do physics, a hard science, but yet they write and they give presentations that show that they don't have an understanding of what we know about people from these fields, then maybe these soft sciences are just too hard for them. So the second thing we can do, the second thing I think that I'm interested in as a tool that we can use to improve how our humanist community works and how people think about the foundations, our kind of foundational philosophy, the way that humanism, where it is that humanism comes from, the way we think about what humanism is with local groups and community groups and campus groups. Partly because I like organizers. I like organizers a lot. I feel like people who get involved in organizing and are decent enough at it to stick with it and stay with it, part of that involves trying to understand people. So you can work with people, so you can get people together to do things together, right? And so organizers kind of have to understand, I'll say social sciences, but a sociological perspective of how people are, what actually works for people. And when I first got involved in this community, when I was 20, half my life ago, geez, a long time ago, it's been 19 years now, the people who I saw at conferences and the people who I saw coming into local groups were almost all scientists, philosophers, different authors of different kinds, professors in different fields, a lot of them sciences or philosophy. I didn't see group organizers and I didn't see group activists out there. That's changed a lot, which I'm very, very happy about because I think it brings a different tone to like how we do what we're trying to do and why. So my second area of recommendation is that we, the movement, work more on helping connect our local leaders, investing in our local groups, training our local leaders, working to facilitate connections with other movements so that we can be effective on the ground where we are and serve people where they are, right? Who are we in West Virginia? What are the needs in West Virginia? I took the train here last night from North Jersey. I'm originally from Philadelphia, but the train goes through some of the most challenging and needy parts of Philadelphia. It's like in an area where my cousins live, actually. And I thought as we were going through, like, what does my movement actually have for the people who live here? They probably, a lot of them don't have college degrees. They probably didn't read The God Delusion in 2006. Would it help if we gave them a copy? Anyway, so that's one of the reasons I'm so excited to get other people to be better at activism, as I learned myself. Again, like when I first got involved, I thought, to be part of this, I have to study why evolution is true and creationism is false, or, you know, all the contradictions in the book of Genesis to prove that God doesn't exist or something. And it took me an embarrassingly long period of time to realize that I could actually learn and study how to be a better organizer. Because I didn't see other people in our movement who call themselves organizers or were doing something that they called organizing. They were doing maybe like group coordination, or sending speakers out, but they weren't actually working with groups to take action on the ground where they were, or to help do outreach better and things like that. And it was pretty eye-opening to me when I found out. So I'm not an expert at it, but I've been doing it for a while. And I know that some of you are organizers and have been involved in this before, so some of this will be old information to you. But for others, I hope that some of the quick information I have to present is useful for helping shape your ability to take action effectively in the future. So why activism? We know. To make the world better. I was a philosophy major, so I always start by defining my terms. It's terrible. A lot of activists don't call themselves activists. They might call themselves other things, but basically, if I'm saying activism, it's taking some action with the intent to bring about change. I also, of course, am an organizer. I talk about organizing. Simply, that's bringing people together for united action. We use that term for, you organize a picnic. You set a date, you rent a space, you contact people, you try to get them to show up somewhere at some time. That's organizing. You organize a rally. A lot of the same skills actually apply. I'm an organizer, or I've been an organizer for a while. A lot of my work has been trying to get people together to do something. I'll be talking first about campaigns, which is like a project. Project is a collection of tasks for some goal. A campaign is a collection of actions with some goal of creating change. And there are a lot of different kinds of campaigns. And again, a lot of the skills involved in these different campaigns overlap. Advertising campaigns. If your goal is sell more Mountain Dew in Q4, and you get together with your advertising team to figure out how to sell more Mountain Dew in Q4, you're gonna be pulling some of the same skills and putting them into use that people who work on election campaigns use. Who do we need to market to? What's our message going to be? Et cetera, et cetera. Some of these campaigns are short-term, other ones are continuing. So I'm going to talk about a rather simplified campaign structure. In different groups I've worked in, we had like an 11-point campaign structure for our campaign, but it actually was kind of this, just with the different parts exploded out. And sometimes people use different words for the different steps, so of course, for those of you who are not as familiar with this, this is not the way, this is not the list that all campaign organizers use. But it's a good one, and I hope that in talking about this, we can all think about approaching our activism and organizing more strategically and intentionally so that we can be more effective. The basics are, you have some goal, some vision, some way that you want the world to be different than it is now. Often these goals are reactive. Something happened, you don't like it, you think, I need to do something about that. Or people come together and say, we need to do something about that. Sometimes they're proactive goals. Objectives are like the pieces of your goal, the winnable issues. For an election campaign, your goal might be get our candidate elected in November. The objectives might be by this date, we want to knock on this many doors. By this date, we want to have this many people signed up. We want to make sure that our candidate has enough petition signatures to get on TV when the debate starts, something like that. Your primary objective is the one that defines the success of your campaign. If you accomplish that, you've accomplished your campaign, basically. The secondary objectives are incremental often. They can help you towards your goal or help you so you don't have to do the same kind of campaign again in the future. The target audience, or target, depending on how you're talking about your campaign, is who it is that has the power to accomplish your goal. For some of the racial justice work I did in Buffalo regarding policing, our target ended up being the mayor because he had the power to hire and fire, and it was his programs that ended up determining how the police department worked, for example. So we're like, how do we affect the mayor to get policing to change in Buffalo? For others, it might be, depending on the kind of campaign you have, all kinds of things. And you might have many different lists, but probably one primary target. The tactics are the specific things you do to accomplish your objectives. And last, I always include evaluation in here. I've seen lists where they don't have that. But I've seen a lot of people engage in work, especially since social media has developed, where they know that they can do a thing, but they don't think about how to measure the impact of the thing they do. I've seen that even in some work environments where we've put information online thinking, you know what, we need to educate people about X, because X is important. Maybe it's vaccines and the fact that they're not connected to autism as far as we know. Okay, let's get everyone researching and writing, make a website. We put the information. Okay, good, we've done it. Nope. And so the evaluation step and incorporating that into thinking about developing our campaign can help us flesh out how to evaluate if there's actual impact. Oh, well, we put a website out. Do we want people to read that? Yeah. Yes, that's actually how things change. How do we get people to read that? Well, now we have to think about outreach and connecting to bloggers or whatever it might be. So this is a very basic format. I'll walk through one quickie campaign. These are other ways of thinking about the questions. You don't have to say like, 1B is this, 2, that. You can ask questions in your thinking about actions to take, like, who are we trying to talk to with this? Why? Why are we trying to talk to them? What should our message be? So, simple example, real fast, and then I'm gonna give you a longer one. Operation Wi-Fi. The problem is, in your town, some parents think Wi-Fi causes cancer. So they wanna get it out of the schools, and they wanna get it out of Starbucks. You think, no, I like my Wi-Fi in Starbucks and for my kids in school. I should do something about this. So your goal is, prevent the elimination of Wi-Fi in public spaces and in schools. Your primary objective? Well, you're thinking about who you need to reach. The parents are gonna talk to the school board to try to get them to vote on this. So you need to persuade the school board on the other side. Don't eliminate Wi-Fi. Your secondary objective for something like this might be, well, you know, the school board will vote this month, but the parents can always put more pressure on them in the future. So maybe you want to also educate the parents and the public about Wi-Fi to kind of neutralize that threat for the future so it won't come up again. Target audience, easy. School board, parents, general public. Tactics, how do you talk to the school board? Attend the school board meeting. How do you talk to the parents? Maybe join the PTA. Maybe make some handouts. Maybe make a website. Give handouts to the kids. Get them on your side. I'm just saying, it works. And how would you evaluate the success of this campaign? If Wi-Fi isn't eliminated, you know you've succeeded. So that's a pretty easy one, a very short, simple goal. I wanted to walk you through a slightly more complex campaign that I got to work on. It was a little messier, but I actually ended up sitting down with this format and writing things out and thinking about how to successfully execute the campaign. So in 2011, when I was working at the Center for Inquiry and as director of African Americans for Humanism, I was able to solicit and acquire a large donation for what ended up being a billboard and ad campaign. The donor's idea was that we would put up billboards during Black History Month in Black neighborhoods with a historical Black atheist and some quote about Black atheism to let Black people know that atheism isn't weird for our community. And he suggested we put these things up in like New York and DC and LA and donated $100,000 to this effect. I've never dealt with a donation that large before. And I was like, yeah, sure, that sounds great. Of course we can do that in 2.5 months. No problem. But as we teased out what the billboard might look like and what the goals of the campaign were and who we wanted to talk to, we ended up tweaking a lot of different things. When we say we, I actually mean me for 95% of this, but we ended up tweaking a lot of the details of this campaign. One, the best quotes about atheism are by historical black atheists whose faces aren't recognizable to most of the public. Hubert Henry Harrison, awesome. No one knows who that guy is. If you want a Frederick Douglass quote, it's either gonna be very long or not atheist-y enough. So we scrapped the idea of a quote. Two, it seemed that we didn't want to just say that this was part of our history, right? It's part of our now. We're in the community. And so we wanted to show that as well. We thought about who we were trying to reach with this campaign. Certainly black people. Which black people? Black religious people, certainly, right? We want to tell black religious people that atheists exist in the black community too, and atheism isn't weird. Also, black non-believers and black questioners, join us. Join our groups. Hey, you're all right, there are others too. So we ended up softening the original message of like, hey, atheists exist, into something else that we thought would be more effective at delivering the message we wanted to our audience. The tactic was already basically determined. We're gonna put up billboards, the main tactic, but we also decided what media to reach out to and whatnot. For any billboard or ad campaign, the media is part of it. It expands your reach. You don't just have the eyes on the board, but also the articles and news stories about the boards, the billboards and ads. So here's what we ended up going with. In New York City, we put up transit ads because fewer black people have cars in New York City. So if we wanted to reach black people, we put them in bus stations and subways. Doubts about religion? Do you have doubts? You're one of many. African Americans for Humanism. We chose several historic black free thinkers, Frederick Douglass, Langston Hughes, and Zora Neale Hurston. And in each of the, we had seven cities, but eight different designs. There were two in DC. It would have been easiest for me to just put my big ass face on these, but less effective. One, because it looks like an outsider. Debbie Goddard, Buffalo, New York, happens to be an atheist. Everyone in Atlanta. And so I had to find people in each city and get a good quality headshot. And you know, we talked about talking points and other things so they could be spokespeople for the campaign. We also try to get people who represented local groups and say, hey, there's a group where you are, Black Non-Believers Atlanta, Black Skeptics LA, so that people could plug in and also knew that there were others there. So this was a New York City design with Leanne Lord. This was a billboard in Dallas with Alex Jules for the Dallas-Fort Worth Coalition of Reason with Langston Hughes. This was the design in Durham, North Carolina, which was the one non-major city that we put them up in. It was Zora Neale Hurston. Was the campaign, oh, there was more. Website. We also built this website. And on it, we included a speakers bureau so that people could get in touch with the different people on the board, but could find others as well. We made a list of historic black humanists so they could find more information about people on the board and others to say like, hey, that's not weird. This is part of our history. There's an example of A. Philip Randolph's bio, for example. So the campaign, I think, was a good success. One person who was invested in the campaign had the concern that because it was the largest simultaneous free thought or atheist campaign ever that we know about, you know, putting up boards in New York and Chicago and Atlanta and Dallas and DC, other places, he thought perhaps that we would get attention from people like Bill O'Reilly, MSNBC. There'd be news stories about this. We'd see black atheists being interviewed on TV. I didn't think that was going to happen, because Bill O'Reilly doesn't care about black people unless he thinks they're attacking white people. But so even though something like a Dave Silverman from American Atheists in the past could have put up boards and Bill O'Reilly would have been interested in interviewing him, this I thought would be outside of his interest, and it was. We did get a lot of attention from BET.com and Ebony and Jet and The Root and The Griot and all of these black media sources, which is where we wanted to be for who our target audience was. People were in magazines, people were on TV, Fox News in Dallas interviewed Alex Jules and things. So I think we did reach our goals and we did reach our audience, but we didn't reach mainstream media, which again was a complaint from one person. So I'm gonna skip my other campaign. Ask me about it sometime. It's interesting. And then with a couple notes. In thinking about how we do this, the kinds of tactics we choose, again, I want to emphasize that, you know, humanism is people. We're people. And working on campaigns in groups, we don't just get frustrated by the people that we're fighting or trying to change. A lot of the frustration comes from the people we're working with to try to change things. Because we're people. And that can be some of the most frustrating, annoying, aggravating times in this, right? Like, but we do it because we care about people, even if we want to murder them sometimes. We care, right? I think we still do. Sometimes we need a break, and then we come back to it. But it's the people fact that makes this so rewarding. So if we want to learn more about activism and campaign building, we can read about movement history for other movements that we're not in. We can look at marketing. You know, if Doritos is paying good money to figure out how to sell more Doritos, we can learn a lot about how people work by looking at what they do that works and doesn't work. McDonald's, they went lowercase with I'm loving it, psh, off the charts. Arch Deluxe made people feel old, no one bought it. Very interesting. Failed as a marketing campaign. I think we can learn a lot from that. But we can look at other things to learn how people work. I talked about social psychology, and I wanted to give a couple examples. Because these, not so smart. Not so reasonable. So talking about tactics, let me give a couple examples. Here's one study. So imagine this. People sign up to participate in a study. They go into the building where the study is taking place. And the researcher says, oh, it's upstairs. We'll have to take the elevator. Let me sign you in. Can you hold my mug for me? And I'll use this clipboard and pen to sign you in. People go upstairs. They read a story, a fictional story about some character. And at the end of reading this, they're asked to rate how warm or cold they find the person they read about. The study was actually about whether the temperature of the beverage they were handed affected their evaluation of the fictional character. Those who were handed warm beverages, more likely to rate the character they read about as warm. Those who were handed cold beverages, more likely to rate them as cold. Because brains. Because ridiculous. And this has been repeated multiple times with, like, evaluating a heating pad or a cooling pad and then writing things about people, and same thing comes up. It's often referred to as priming. Our environment affects us. The decisions we make, the rational process that we engage in, etc. And we do understand this, right? If your boss had a flat tire in a snowstorm and is feeling pretty miserable, that's not the day to ask them for a raise. We know that. Another example. It's one of my favorites. Some researchers at some university, Newcastle University, were like, we notice a lot of people who use the cafeteria just leave their crap, but they don't throw it out when they're done. We wonder if putting posters with eyes on them would get people to change their behavior. So some days, for about a month, every day they put up some posters. Some days it had eyes, some days it had neutral images, like flowers. They tried men with eyes, the posters, and women's eyes. And they found, at the end, that when they had the posters with eyes, twice as many people cleaned up after themselves. It's weird. So they published this. Then they did it with the honesty box in their lunchroom. some people weren't paying for their coffee and things. Like, what if we put some eyes on it? Other days, flowers. People paid three times more when there were eyes on it. So they're like, hey, let's publish that. But there's more. There was a bike rack outside their university office and some bikes got stolen from it. And they were like, you know what? What if we put some eyes on that? Cycle thieves, we are watching you. When they placed this message by the bike rack, bike thefts went down 62%. So, as activists, we might see these kinds of studies floating around Facebook and other places. What can we do with this kind of information? Well, say you're implementing a recycling program at your office. You know, people, instead of just throwing their stuff out, have to separate cans and bottles and other stuff. They have to break that habit, that behavior that they're engaged in. Well, it might be helpful if you say, hey, please recycle cans and bottles here. Put some eyes on it. Maybe not these eyes, friendlier eyes, right? But there are tools like this that all the time come out of that can help us tweak and improve our activism. I included the study data, though I didn't expect anyone to read that on here because I don't have time to go into all of the details about these studies, but as you see, I've learned that charts are persuasive. See? They are. And for those of you who think, well, you're a science-minded person, I talk to skeptics sometimes, I wouldn't be fooled by this. The researchers who did this study, when they asked people to rate on a scale of 1 to 9, I believe in science, those who said more strongly that they believe in science were more likely to be persuaded by charts and graphs. So, I have one more example. Yeah, time. I'm gonna skip foot in the door. Social norms. Ah, this is one of my favorites. And it'll be my last example. Persuasion researcher, which is a job that I really think I might enjoy. A persuasion researcher is staying at a hotel, and you ever see those signs in hotel rooms that say, please reuse your towel? Why do they tell you to reuse your towel? Save the trees, save the water, save the environment. They don't say, save us money, reuse your towel. I don't know who said that. That's what they mean, but they don't tell you that. They're like, hey, green things, save the environment. So this persuasion research is like, well, what if we let people know that other people at this hotel reuse their towel? So they tweaked the signs and changed the message to say, please reuse your towel. The majority of guests in this hotel reuse their towel. That increased towel reuse by 26%. And when they tweaked it further to say, please reuse your towel, the majority of guests in room 306, where you happen to be, reuse their towel, that increased it by 33%. So if you set the expectations for behavior, you know, please recycle, 79% of people in Austin recycle. Again, people are more likely to act the way that they think they're expected to act based on the groups that they're in. So that has to be my last example, which is fine. I wanted to give credit to the people that I've learned from and been examples from. The Skeptical Activism Manual, which is free online, use the Operation Wi-Fi example and the simplified campaign structure. It's, I think, a 72-page PDF downloadable. It was created by these three wonderful skeptic activists, Marie Walters, Desiree Schell, and K.O. Myers. One book where you can find a bunch of fun social psychology examples and examples of how to connect that to improve our activism is this book, Change of Heart, What Psychology Can Teach Us About Spreading Social Change by Nick Cooney. Dan Kahan does a lot of work on social identity theory, particularly regarding the different ways that liberals and conservatives approach issues and how things like climate change have been connected to identity, how that affects our thinking. And this book, Stirred Up, Lessons in Community Organizing and Advocacy by Rinku Sen, has great overviews of different theories of organizing and the different ways that movements have worked over time. It's like a textbook. It's pretty dense. I could probably benefit from rereading it myself. But those are my examples. I'll be at my table. I do want to mention one thing. Now that I'm at American Atheists, I've been there for 3 months, and I'm settling in. I'm really happy to be there and really happy to get the opportunity to work with the network of grassroots groups and to help advance some of the things I talked about regarding challenging the problems we see in the freethought community and what we can do to improve our community there. There's a American Atheists National Convention is in Cincinnati in 3 weeks, and there are focus groups. We're doing data collection to figure out what people who are part who are atheists and non-religious people think we should be doing as a community, as a movement, as an organization, what the needs are, what kinds of discrimination people face, why or why not they're involved, for example. So if you're attending the convention, we want to make sure that we have a broad range of representation. So if you are going, stop by my table. There's a website to sign up for the focus group so that we can make sure to get participation from a lot of different kinds of people. And yeah, change the world. On there, thank you.